So I want to talk about an interesting paradox, which is the title of this idea, which is called rational idealism. And normally when we think about idealism, or what we could call utopian idealism, to make it even more extreme, the idea of utopian idealism, or even the idea of utopia itself, is usually by very sophisticated, intelligent, philosophically oriented people is often considered to be a non-rational, dangerous idea. So I'd like to speak about this non-rational, dangerous idea a little bit. And let's see where we go with it. The interesting thing about enlightenment, the evolution of consciousness, the experience of higher states of consciousness that awakened us to enlightened awareness, is that they reveal to us transrational truths about the nature of reality. That there are certain perspectives that we can glimpse in these higher states that we can directly experience that are definitely not rational at all. As a matter of fact, they can seem, from a rational perspective, as being very crazy. So I just like to start at the beginning and say that the higher truths that bestow upon us a glimpse of spiritual liberation and enlightened awareness definitely transcend the category of anything we could call rational. And that's kind of the basis of what I want to speak about. I remember when I started on the path about 35 years ago, like many people, I was doing a lot of Buddhist meditation retreats, Vipassana retreats, many of us got trained in along the way. And I remember that my first spiritual teacher, enlightened spiritual teachers, if they're authentically enlightened and authentically awake, have a capacity to convey a level of inspiration about our own potential for evolving at the level of consciousness and our own potential to glimpse enlightened states of awareness. If you see someone, spend time with someone, spend time in the presence or the company of someone who has access to these, what I would call miraculous higher states of consciousness, those such individuals can convey to us or transmit to us or embody for us a higher potential for ourselves. So I remember my first spiritual teacher was an Indian guru who died a long time ago. His name was Swami Hariharananda Giri, and he was in the lineage of Kriya Yoga with Paramahansa Yogananda, and his guru, Sri Yukteswar. And I never met anybody like that before, because he was always smiling. And when he wasn't a great speaker, he didn't give very good talks, because his English and his rational faculty sometimes seemed a little incoherent, speaking of being rational. So his talks were, I found them quite incoherent and difficult to follow. But when he would laugh and he would giggle and he would smile, he would radiate the knowledge of a higher dimension of reality that I was desperate to gain access to. And he was very consistent in that. And he would do things like say, my mango is very sweet. And he would often speak with unrestricted passion about his experience of higher states of consciousness. and about how profound and how powerful, how extraordinary, how miraculous, how liberating they were, and how this had changed his life and was continuing to change his life. And he spoke with such a sense of authority and honesty and integrity about these experiences that there was no doubt that he was speaking honestly about what was his own direct experience. And it was clear that his experience was very different than ours. He was living in a different plane of consciousness, and his relationship to reality was very different because he had access to these higher states. And his access to those higher states made all the difference. So while I found in many ways when I told you, just to repeat, when he gave talks, I found him quite incoherent when it came to being rational in terms of giving a talk. But beyond that, he conveyed the truth of the enlightenment that he was trying to share with us, trying to transmit to us, and was so earnestly bearing witness to. So his example had a big effect on me. So around the same time I met him, a friend of mine introduced me to Buddhism and to these long sitting retreats that one could go on for 10 days, 20 days, a few months at a time. And I remember I thought this was just fantastic. I said, wow, you can sit in this meditation hall for 16, 18, 20 hours a day if you want. And for me, that was my idea of heaven at the time. But I remember this was a very different environment, and all of the talks were very coherent, very rational, very consistent. They were philosophically consistent, metaphysically consistent. And they created a metaphysical and philosophical framework that was very convincing and very intricate and ornate. But none of the teachers who were teaching us meditation, some of whom have been at it for many, many, many years, conveyed anywhere near that sense of spontaneous joy and inner freedom that this Indian guru had. They knew all about enlightenment from a technical point of view, from a philosophical point of view, and from a scriptural point of view. But none of them transmitted it or conveyed it in the way he did, so spontaneously, effortlessly, and naturally. So I found this very confusing. Because whatever enlightenment is, he definitely found it, and it found him. Whereas most of these other teachers seem to me to be good teachers and good technicians, and had a good grasp of the theory, but they didn't seem to be swimming in the altered state of consciousness that I was looking for. And then finally, an English teacher came to town, an English man who had been a monk for a long time, who was teaching the same practice, but he was different because he would sometimes just start laughing spontaneously. He had an outburst of laughter, and he would wink. And he seemed to know the secret, whatever the secret is, he was in on it. And he was the only teacher in that tradition that kind of inspired me to stick with it a little bit longer. Because his laugh, his wink, conveyed the fact that he knew something mysterious that was the source of liberation, which is what we were trying to do. That's what the whole point of meditation is all about, is to find liberation. And he wasn't just speaking about it, but he also was transmitting it in a way that was compelling. And what and what people who awaken to enlightened awareness convey is transrational knowledge, transrational knowing, transrational gnosis. And it's important to understand this. I'm not advocating that the mind is not a very important friend. And I've always been a great believer in a fiercely rational spirituality, and I think I've been a fairly consistent proponent and exemplar of a rational approach to enlightenment. So I am very much, I try to be a rational guy. as much as I can. But I get to sense these days in some very sophisticated circles, when it comes to higher states of consciousness and the possibility of awakening to enlightened awareness, I think too many people are losing the plot. Because without getting to that point when we actually transcend our rational faculties in a way that is radical and quite extreme, we're never gonna take the leap beyond the mind. It's all about taking that leap beyond the mind. So unless we're willing to dispense with our rational faculties for a period of time, we'll never be able to glimpse what lays beyond the mind. And that's where the secret is. That's where the mystery abides. And when I finally met my guru, the great H.W.L. Punjo, the disciple of Ramana Maharshi in 1986, his calm abiding in an altered state of consciousness beyond the mind was absolutely amazing. And he spoke about enlightenment or enlightened awareness with a sense of immediacy that I found quite shocking. When I met him, he started taking my own potential for enlightenment more seriously than I was. And I was a pretty serious guy, still am. But I never met somebody who seemed to be so acquainted with enlightenment from direct experience. And he spoke about it so, like my first guru, he spoke about it so passionately and so directly from what seemed to be the immediacy of his own experience. But enlightenment for him was not far away. It was here and now. And he was transmitting it. He was radiating it. And the strangest things would happen around him. One day I was sitting with him in his living room. And a rather ordinary older Indian woman came in. She didn't look remarkable in any way. And he said, ask her about her experience. She's enlightened. And I said, and I thought, he must be crazy. I didn't know where. I thought it just sounded absurd and ridiculous. He said, no, no, Andrew, go and speak to her. Ask her about her experience. So I can't remember the question I asked her, but I asked her some question about meditation. And without missing a beat, without hesitating, he said, oh, that's good for beginners. And she said it with a totally straight face. And she responded quicker than faster than thought. She said, oh, that's good for beginners. So her spiritual self-confidence in terms of awakening to enlightened awareness was unparalleled and something I'd never seen this before. I never met so many people in such a short period of time who seemed to have access to enlightened awareness. This made a very powerful impression on me. If the goal is to gain spiritual self-confidence, if the goal is to awaken to enlightened awareness, then we've got to do whatever we need to do to gain access, to succeed in our endeavor to awaken. I personally feel very passionately that if enlightenment is what we're compelled by, the promise of enlightenment, the potential for enlightenment, then we've got to give it everything we've got. We've got to do anything and everything we can to have these experiences of higher states of consciousness that blow our mind and blow our heart wide open. And I think we need to stop pretending that is not the most important thing, because it is. Being utterly knocked over and overwhelmed by the potential of consciousness to reveal the ultimate truth about the nature of reality is what this is all about. You know, what it's always been about and what it's always going to be about. Psychotherapy can help us to clean up our act, but it won't help to liberate us, not in the end. And the thing about higher states is they're very elusive. They're very mysterious. Here, they can be here one day and gone tomorrow. And one of the most mysterious things about higher states of consciousness I've come to fine from a perspective of teaching is that I've seen over the years countless people wake up to these higher states. And when they're in these higher states, glimpse the ultimate or absolute nature of reality, and as a result, become absolutely illuminated or lit up by the fire of consciousness and the knowing of consciousness, the knowing of non-duality from their own inner experience, from their own direct experience. And that, as we know, at least temporarily changes everything. When you directly experience the non-dual or absolute nature of reality, your mind is thrown out the window and you begin to see reality through a different lens. And that different lens changes everything, because there is inherent in the vision of non-duality and the direct experience of non-duality, is non-duality is not just the conscious perception or conscious cognition of a great singularity, of all is one and one is all is you all have heard about. That's part of it. The experiencing the inherent non-dual singularity that is all of reality is a part of it. And it's an important part of it. But I think what's more important is that in the radiance of the non-dual vision, in the radiance of the non-dual experience, in the radiance of the non-dual knowing, there is the direct gnosis of a indescribable and overwhelming pure positivity. But it's a pure positivity that is transrational and non-relative. Non-relative means the totality of reality falls into two categories according to Mahayana Buddhism. There's a distinction between what's called relative reality and absolute reality. Relative reality and absolute reality are two different dimensions of cognition, of perception, and of existence, of manifestation. So relative reality is the place where the unenlightened mind and unenlightened consciousness and cognition predominate. Manifest reality. So-called normal state of consciousness. But when we awaken to absolute reality, this non-relative dimension of consciousness, it's a flip from one dimension to another. And in this definitely higher dimension, there is the unequivocal, undoubted recognition in this higher state that what one is experiencing, or the way one is seeing and feeling and knowing reality in that higher state that is non-relative, is that this non-relative perception is inherently more real. And everybody who makes this flip says, oh my goodness, in this state of consciousness, I'm experiencing reality with much more depth and authenticity. This is real. In comparison to this state of consciousness, relative reality is seen to be unreal. But in this higher state of non-relative perception, consciousness, and cognition, I'm experiencing reality as being infinitely more real. This is real. And in comparison to this absolute perception of greater reality, relative reality is seen and felt as being unreal. And this is a very important distinction. Because if it's true, and it is true, but you have to have the experience to know that it's true, would you want to live in a relationship to reality that's fundamentally recognized to be unreal and false and partial? Or would you want to have a relationship to reality that is real and absolute and intoxicating? So, but the point I wanted to make was that inherent in the non-dual vision is the direct perception, the direct gnosis or cognition of pure positivity. That inherent in this ultimate or absolute perspective is a knowledge or a knowing of reality itself in its essence that is indescribably positive. overwhelmingly positive, inconceivably positive. It's a recognition that the very essence of reality, which is not a thing, the very heart of reality itself, in the very heart of reality itself, is a pure positivity. It's absolutely undefiled by anything that the mind could come up with. So what happens when you see the face of God? You recognize a purity and a perfection that is mind-boggling, awe-inspiring. That's what brings us to our knees. It's the direct cognition of this pure positivity that's so life-transforming. And we know this is very important because smart, sensitive, thoughtful people want to know, is existence a good thing? When something came from nothing, was it a big yes? Was it a big no? Was it a big neutral? Is life inherently good or is life inherently a bad trip? As most people seem to feel that it is. And we have to take this seriously because a lot of the smartest, most sensitive, thoughtful people haven't had the kind of awakening I'm describing to you and are therefore not so sure that life is inherently a good thing because there's so much suffering, so much confusion, so much fear, so much doubt. So much depression, anxiety, self-concern, terror. So when we make this leap from relative reality to absolute reality, and in this leap from absolute reality, we have a direct gnosis or cognition of the fact that inherent in the ultimate nature of reality is a pure positivity. Inherent in the ultimate nature of reality is a pure positivity. A pure positivity that is its nature is purely positive, the essence of reality itself. Don't take my word for it. I'm just saying if you have the experience, you'll see that it's true. That's why people who are truly enlightened, which means they have access to these higher states on a regular basis. When you go deep enough into these experiences of higher states, it changes you. It changes you at a level of the soul. Because you know this absolute truth beyond the mind, by the way, beyond the rational mind. And you know that it's true. Even if the whole world is going to hell with everyone in it, it doesn't change the absolute truth. And if you know that, it gives you spiritual self-confidence, even if you're on the Titanic. It's not that you don't care. You do care, but you know that whatever's going to happen on that ship won't ultimately change the highest and deepest truth about the ultimate nature of reality, which is that inherent in this mysterious process called existence, inherent at the very core level of existence, is a pure positivity that's indescribable and ultimately completely overwhelming. So there's this distinction between relative reality and absolute reality. And we get these glimpses of this pure positivity, indescribable pure positivity, when we awaken to the non-relative, absolute dimension of reality. And as an experience of a higher state of consciousness. Now, what we'll notice is that most of the great realizers not only had a profound awakening to non-relative or absolute reality, but their awakening was usually so deep, so profound, so life-transforming, so mesmerizing, that they came back from these higher states with a great vision, a vision of the possible, a vision of heaven on earth, a vision of utopia. The experience of these higher states of consciousness inspire most realizers to try to bring this vision of perfection, this experience of perfection, to try to bring it into manifest relative reality, This is when things get tricky and where they usually go all wrong. But before we get there, I just want to make this point that the deepest and most profoundly life-changing experiences of higher states of consciousness almost always, not in every case, but almost always, inspire the realizer to want to transform relative reality, the world of time and space, self and other, world and culture, to want to transcend the relative world, relative reality, into a vision, into a vision of absolute reality, which means I've been to heaven, I've seen heaven, heaven is real, heaven exists, and now I want to try and create heaven on earth. It's called the utopian vision. In Buddhism, in Mahayana Buddhism, they call it the land of Shambhala. So it seems that in most cases that inherent in the profound spiritual realization is the inspired compulsion to try and create this heavenly realm, to turn this heavenly realm that we experience as a spiritual state or as a vision. We want to try and transform the relative world into that vision, to make that vision come alive in this manifest reality. And that's what all spiritual groups and spiritual cults throughout history have tried to do. They wanted to come together, awaken to these higher states of consciousness, have the spiritual vision, and try to actualize it in this world. More often than not, failing miserably. But I want you just to get an idea of how this works. Because these vision of perfection that we experience, it becomes clear to us when we wake into enlightened awareness. It's not just the experience of the inherent perfection at the very core of reality, but it's also, we see what's possible beyond the mind, beyond fear, beyond doubt, beyond duality, beyond division, beyond ego, individual ego, cultural ego, tribal ego, male ego, female ego, beyond all differences of self and other. World and cosmos, beyond all differences, there's a vision of what's possible. When you experience these higher states of consciousness, you see, this is the truth. This is the truth. And if you really have a very strong experience, you feel yourself hopelessly compelled to try to mold the relative world, relative reality, in that image. Good luck. But that's how it works. That's how it always works. So I want everybody to understand this utopian idealism as a product of the experience of higher states of consciousness when they're very deep. Because when you've seen this perfection and this inconceivable goodness, when it's touched your heart so deeply, you want to share it. It wants to be known, and you feel that it wants to be known through you. And so there comes upon you an indescribable compulsion to bear witness to the possible. I've seen what's possible. I've seen what's possible. I've experienced what's possible. I know what's possible. Now I want to try and make it happen. Does anybody have anything better to do? Settle for compromise, maybe? When you've seen what's possible and experienced what's possible in such a way that is so utterly, utterly radical and utterly uncompromised, a truly inspired person feels there's nothing left for me to do but then to do whatever I can do to actualize this extraordinary truth, this vision in relative reality. That's the transformation of the interior of the cosmos. I want to transform the interior of the cosmos from this bleak dimension of fear and insecurity to one of love and joy and celebration. This is what spiritually inspired people feel like, even if they're crazy. So, in this vision of absolute reality, we glimpse perfection. And I want to make it very clear, as I often do on this point, that we can glimpse perfection as a higher state of, in a higher state of consciousness. We can glimpse perfection. We can see it. We can feel it. We can know that which is perfect, absolutely perfect, indescribably perfect, unimaginably perfect. But relative reality is part of a process, part of an evolutionary and creative process that's in a process of constant change and development. Relative reality is not static. Relative reality is, as the Buddha himself stated, in a state of constant change, development, rising and falling, moving and changing. So we can never reach perfection in relative reality. Perfection cannot be attained in relative reality. We can see perfection, experience perfection, and know perfection in absolute, in a vision of absolute reality. We can know perfection undoubtedly in a vision of absolute reality and the experience of absolute reality and the awakening to absolute reality, but we can't attain perfection in relative reality. It's unattainable because we're in a developmental process where we're always reaching for something that's possible, but never ultimately reached or attained. So in absolute reality, we can glimpse perfection. In relative reality, we can't attain perfection. But we can reach for it. And this is the kicker. If you reach for perfection in relative reality, whether you're a tennis player, or a photographer, or a musician, or a philosopher, if you reach with all of your heart and all of your might and all of your soul, if you reach for perfection, you're going to get a lot closer to reaching it than if you don't even try. So once again, we can glimpse perfection in absolute reality, but we can't attain perfection in relative reality. But don't give up. A lot of people realize this and then they say, well, there's no point in even trying, then I might as well just accept things as they are, which is a very popular spiritual technique. Be with what is and accept things as they are. Why? Things can be so much better than they are, so much more extraordinary, profound, miraculous, amazing. They really can. But you've got to believe it. And don't take my word for it. The only way you're going to believe it, if you have these experiences that demonstrate it to you in your own soul, then you're going to know, oh, things could be so much better. I've experienced so much joy, peace, and happiness, exhilaration, love, ecstasy, and so much pure potential. That kind of experience inspires us to want to reach higher and to reach higher and to reach higher. So once again, how I see this making sense and this working is that if we glimpse these higher states, which show us the ultimate nature of reality as it is, those higher state experiences can inspire us to reach higher and farther within the context of relative reality, in the context of this human experience of being human, the higher we reach, the more extraordinary the potentials are going to be that emerge through us. So how high are we reaching? How far are we actually trying to go? Are we reaching for the stars? Because for those people who reach for the stars, see things, know things, understand things in a way that people who don't reach for the stars are never going to know. So the way I see it is that the experience of higher states of consciousness can be sources of non-relative or absolute inspiration. Inspiration to reach higher, to try harder, to have even more faith. Oh my goodness, really? Yes, to have even more faith. And to be willing to make more effort. And not to settle for less than everything. And if I'm not willing to settle for less than everything, and you're not willing to settle for less than everything, then together, as we engage with each other in this human drama, our mutual yearning and reaching will catalyze higher possibilities and higher potentials to emerge between us. So, but what's very important, it's very important to know that that perfection can be seen, but it can't be actualized. You can see that which is perfect, and you can experience that which is perfect, but you can never reach it. You can never actualize it. You can never manifest perfection. No human being can manifest perfection, but we can all experience perfection. And the more we experience perfection, the more we're going to want to try to actualize it and manifest it, the more we're going to be inspired to do everything we can to actualize it and manifest it. And that gives rise to what I call a creative evolutionary tension. And if we're spiritually inspired, we want to kind of actualize this evolutionary tension. And what will inspire us to actualize that evolutionary tension in the context of our relative reality of our relative lives is the vision and the direct gnosis and cognition of absolute non-duality, directly experiencing the inherent perfection that lies at the very center of everything that is. So why I chose the title Rational Idealism is that we want to have the audacious courage to embrace utopian idealism in all its promise while having a fiercely rational understanding of the way reality actually works, knowing that we're never going to actually be able to actualize it. We want to hold that paradox very much alive in our hands and heart. I see utopia as an experience, as a higher state of consciousness. And I want the world that I'm living in, and I'm co-creating with everyone else, to become an expression of that utopian vision, while fully knowing that we're never going to get there. And even though I know we're never going to get there, we're going to try. We be mediated and moderated by rational discrimination, which should keep us sane. Because if we're not careful, if we try to actualize perfection in a context in which it can never be actualized, we're going to make a mess. This is why so many utopian experiments have failed so miserably. Because this distinction between absolute truth and relative truth was not understood. Relative reality is relative reality, and you can only always go so far. But if we are trying to revolutionize relative reality, inspired by a vision of absolute reality, the world that we're living in, we're co-creating together, can become such an extraordinarily, profoundly positive, co-creative, reflection of the possible. But how, what a delicate paradox we all have to learn how to hold. To repeat, we can all know that which is perfect, but we can never be that which is perfect. We can know that which is perfect, but we can never be that which is perfect. It doesn't intimidate me. If we have if we have fragile egos, oh, if I can't be perfect, well, I give up. No, we got to grow up and be stronger than that. No, we can't be perfect. We're never going to reach perfection. But we want to try and reach it. We want to try and reach the perfection anyway, fully knowing beforehand that we're never going to get there. And that's where the action is. That's where evolutionary emergence comes from, holding that tension, that paradox. It requires a bit of spiritual heroism and metaphysical exuberance and audacity. And learning how to hold these two truths is a big part of what it means to be a mature realizer. Holding the paradox, embracing the paradox, and living the paradox earnestly. So, for example, if we're truly audacious, we want to have the courage to bear witness to that perfection. In a cynical world that's so full of doubt and arrogance and nihilism, that takes courage to bear witness, to choose to bear witness as yourself to that perfection in such a cynical, nihilistic, doubtful, fearful, angry world space. That takes courage. As I always like to say, consciousness delights in its own self-recognition. So if I can share my awakened inspiration with you, it can awaken that same inspiration in you. And then if you catch fire, you can awaken that same inspiration in others. So while I feel that our metaphysical aspirations need to be mediated and moderated by a ferocious, rational, contemplative, observing vision, we don't want the unbelievable potential that exists to be suffocated by being too rational about all this. We want to use our rational faculties to help us stay on the right track, but we don't want them to suffocate and snuff out the fire of unconditional liberation, as it can and as it does and as it will, if we're not careful, if we get too smart about all this. We can kill God without even knowing we're doing it, because we're just too smart for our own good. As long as we privilege the mind, in the end, God's going to disappear. So we want to learn how to be very sophisticated thinkers while simultaneously being experts in transcending the mind and throwing it into the garbage can. When necessary, which is probably every day, a few times. So this is why I use the title Rational Idealism. Now you can understand why. I think we need to have the courage to be idealistic. It takes guts. It's not cool to be too idealistic. People think if you get too idealistic, too inspired by this pure positivity, people think you're naive, foolish, dangerously so probably. But deep and profound realizers are wild characters who've shun convention. You're not afraid of the audacious nature of this pure positivity. You're not afraid to be exemplars of it in the face of a disbelieving world. And that's a challenge for all of us if we're sincere, I believe. Just to repeat, we can experience perfection, but we can't be perfection. It doesn't mean we shouldn't always try to be better. Try to be more perfect. And we want to try and embrace the tension between the tension inherent in reaching for a perfection that can't be reached. We want to try to give this higher consciousness no excuse not to work through us. If we leave too much room for self-doubt and self-hatred and self-loathing, and fear, depression, nihilism, and arrogance, the consciousness won't show its face. We need to be worthy vehicles of this vision of perfection, which means you've got to believe in it. You've got to trust in it and have great, so much faith. And this consciousness will know if that's your position. If you have that much faith and have that much conviction, that consciousness will reveal itself to you, within you, will start to speak through you. So while we need the mind, we need to be good thinkers, to be smart people, to help us to make right choices. We don't want to be a slave to rational thinking. We don't want the rational mind to be our God, but our servant. Enlightened awareness is not reasonable. It's not rational. It's unreasonable and transrational. It doesn't fit in to anything. And it blows everything out of the water. So we want to try and have liberated and unconditioned awareness, liberated unconditioned enlightened awareness, and rational thinking, but not rational thinking and then a little bit of enlightened awareness. You let go of the mind, you have to let go of your ego too, because the two work together. A lot of people want to let go of their mind, but their mind doesn't seem to want to go away. And they don't realize that it's because their ego is trying to let go, trying to do the letting go. It doesn't work that way. Your ego will never let go of your mind. It'll never let go of the mind. So if your ego has usurped your spiritual impulse, if your ego is trying to get enlightened, it ain't never going to work, of course. So the difficult part in all this, and it sounds very mundane or trite even, but it's true. And if you want to awaken to enlightened awareness, to transrational gnosis, consciousness and cognition. The ego's got to take a hike. It has to go away. It has to be transcended fiercely, ferociously, absolutely, and completely, at least for a few moments. You have to be able to stand free from your ego. Stand free from your ego, your mind will also be transcended. And then you get a glimpse of higher consciousness. We'll make that leap from relative to absolute perspectives. You start to see things differently. Reality will appear so differently. You get a glimpse of who you really are and who you can be. We all can be so much more than we think is possible because we're always just thinking about this very rationally. We have to be unreasonable at a certain point. Life itself isn't very reasonable, is it? So if we want to awaken in a way that's profound and outrageous, we have to also be unreasonable. Take enormous risks and have unimaginable faith. Very good. So if anybody has any questions, I'll be happy to try and answer them. But be reasonable. Be pleased when you ask your questions. Be reasonable and rational and kind and respectful.
I have a first question from Sally.
Yeah, sure. Hi, Sally.
She is asking, can you make a distinction between perfectionism, fear of failure, and glimpsing perfection, means inspiration? These two drive us in different ways, carrot and stick.
Well, perfectionism comes from the ego. And ask me the question again.
Yeah. Can you make a distinction between perfectionism, fear of failure, and glimpsing perfection, inspiration? These two seem to drive us in different ways, carrot and stick.
Well, the glimpse of perfection is an experience of perfection, of completeness, wholeness. But I think we have to be careful here, because I think we want to have a measure of perfectionism, but not to overdo it. We want to try and always do a little better. We want to always try and do a little better, and we realize that we are all works in progress, no matter who we think we are, or how enlightened we may think we are, or unenlightened we may think we are. We're all forever works in progress. So if we understand that from an evolutionary point of view, we're all works in progress, it means we're never going to reach perfection, as I was saying, in relative reality. It's just, it's unattainable, it's unreachable. So I guess there is a spiritually healthy inspiration to want to do better and be better for its own sake. And then there can be, I guess, a neurotic, unreasonable self-judgment and self-criticism, and nothing we're capable of doing ever being good enough. And that's just a bad trip. But if we know that we can't reach perfection, we can't manifest perfection, if we really know that at a very deep level, that kind of should put us at rest a little bit. And I think we all know when we're doing our best or trying to do our best earnestly and sincerely, and when we're not. We all know. And nobody's going to be doing their best and trying their best all the time, even if we do most of the time. No, because nobody's perfect. So to me, I don't know if I'm answering your question, but to me, that's embracing this paradox between seeing perfection and trying to reach perfection, but knowing we're never going to reach it. There's something that's endlessly fascinating to me, compelling about it, and intriguing, and deeply challenging at a human level. So he says, I'm supposed to try and reach perfection, but then accept the fact that I'm never going to reach it. That sounds like a contradiction. It is a contradiction. But embracing that contradiction and paradox opens up a possibility for all of us to be so much better than we can be.
Yeah, that's wonderful. Thank you, Andrew. And I sometimes feel like with clients that I have, if they're being driven by a compulsion from the past, they're often perfectionists, but it's like a fear of failure, fear of not being loved. And that's really different from being inspired forward into a future.
Exactly, exactly. Very yeah. different. And what you brought up is very important, because a lot of us are neurotic. A lot of us are neurotic, and we torture ourselves because we're conditioned robots that don't know any better than to torture ourselves for no good reason than to suffer. So part of all this has to do with the, as you're well aware of, awakening to the complexity and the pathos of the human condition, and seeing the complexity and the pathos of the human condition in ourselves as ourselves, and having compassion for the whole process in ourselves as ourselves. It creates a lot more room for us to be able to embrace our own complexity from a place of inspiration and acceptance.
Yeah, I think one is vision driven and one is fear driven, but they can look the same. One is
absolutely, completely true.
Thank you.
But what we want to do is to not let ourselves off the hook.
Yeah.
Because bad experiences, pain and suffering, it's either the result of external forces or self-inflicted, can cause us to lose confidence. And if the minute we begin to lose confidence, self-confidence, we won't try as hard anymore. We'll be more concerned with our woundedness and our painful feelings than we will in the promise of this, the metaphysical potential that's always there. Because, yeah, so we need to love ourselves and forgive ourselves and get on with the more inspiring spiritual work, but not let ourselves off the hook. And on a human level, that's very hard. It's why is it hard? Because we're all imperfect. Because we're imperfect, we'll make mistakes. We'll betray ourselves without even intending to do so. And we'll start seeing that how we're bumbling around so much of the time. And out of that bumbling can the most extraordinary things can suddenly appear. So we want to learn how to hold all this in, from a perspective of really appreciating what a complex and hilarious business this is, trying to be conscious. And so once again, there has to be a lot of self-forgiveness, but at the same time, not letting ourselves off the hook. And if we don't let ourselves off the hook, there's not really any breaks in the call for the highest. So it's just that paradox that we want to really be able to work with even more deeply. Because it's the ego that's saying, well, I've been working very hard on this for the last 10 minutes and now it's time to take a break. Because look, waking up is hard, but staying awake is even harder. So
happens.
Thank you, Sally.
The next question is from Jill. He is asking, we all know that relationships are at the top or near the top of what makes us suffer. What are your ideas for working on our relationships and trying to achieve heaven in the domain of relationships? Specific examples, please, if you can. Also, can you speak about forgiveness? How did you forgive someone who, say, betrayed you?
Wow. Okay. Can you read it again?
Yep. We all know that relationships are at the top or near the top of what makes us.
Oh, suffer. No, I got that. I'm sorry. I remember. So the thing about who was asking the question?
Gil. Me.
Gil.
Yep. Hi, Gil. Yeah. No. So the thing is, Gil, that the issue with relationships, from my point of view, becomes very complex because our relationships with different people are based on different contexts. So your relationship with your mother, your father, and your sister, and your brother is going to be different contexts than your relationship with your personal friends. It's going to be different than your relationship with the people from work. Is going to be different from your relationship with the people who you share your spiritual and metaphysical aspirations with. So, the area of relationships, I agree with you, is the most important arena. It's the most important challenging arena for all of us, and that's where the rubber meets the road for sure. But to put it very simply, I have come to find again and again and again that what makes the experience of profound and mutually gratifying intense intimacy possible between two or more human beings is our shared values and shared aspirations. So in my experience, it's only with people who share my values, my aspirations, my deepest convictions, that I can experience a profound ego-transcending intimacy with that is deeply rewarding and deeply gratifying and that makes life worth living. Most of the time, when I experience a friendliness with people who we don't share the same values, really, we don't share the same aspirations, really, we don't share the same convictions, really, it becomes very hard to experience this ego-transcending, world-transcending intimacy that makes life so deeply worth living. It's more of an experience of being polite and being kind. And being polite and being kind is nice, but it ain't deep. So again, I'm kind of a radical character, so take everything I'm saying with a grain of salt, but I find that human relationships and the experience of relatedness, that experiences of relatedness with other people that are less than deep, tend not to be that interesting and can be for me experiencing as being tedious after a while. So we should always be kind and respectful to other people, but not all relationships we have with each other are the same. They don't pay the same dividends or make the same requirements of us. I find often when one wakes up in a way that's very deep and profound, one begins to realize is that if you spend most of your time with people who are not also deeply awake, that people's lives are lived in sure shallow waters. And shallow waters can be suffocating after a while, even if they can be pleasant and sweet, they won't be deeply rewarding. So this issue about relationships and relatedness depends upon how deep you want to go and how important that is to you, what your values are, because there's different levels of intimacy. And if we awaken in a very deep way, the only kind of intimacy that sets us free is intimacy based upon this realization of non-relative or absolute reality. When you can share that consciousness, the consciousness of non-relative or absolute reality, with another human being or other human beings, you can truly experience a oneness that, as I said, truly makes life worth living. I also think that the most important thing in human relationships, I mean, that really gives relationships spiritual value, is the presence of trust. That, to me, that's the most important. If I love you and you love me, if we really believe that we value each other and that we deeply love each other, then what it means beyond the feeling of love is that there's I deeply trust you, deep trust, that you deeply trust me, and it's that mutual trust that gives us both the experience of being spiritually free in the context of relationship. The trust is the most important thing. So whether it's a romantic and sexual relationship, whether it's a friendship, spiritual friendship, the presence of deep trust is what makes it possible to experience freedom in the context of relationship. And the more freedom we experience in the context of relationship and relatedness, the more the bonds we feel between us will be a source of ecstasy and the affirmation of life. But we know that trust is a delicate thing and it's easily broken. And when trust is broken, it's unbelievably painful, and it causes us to doubt ultimately in life itself. If we feel our heart has been broken and betrayed one too many times, we begin to give up on the inherent goodness of life, which is the vision I was speaking about in my talk, which is vision of perfection. We begin to doubt even that, even if we've experienced it, because we're so hurt. So the test of human relationships and relatedness is trust. Because Gil, I'm quite convinced that if you really trust me and I really trust you, if we would know each other long enough and had built up a structure in which our relationship made sense to both of us, and if we made a decision to trust each other, then I believe there's no challenge that we couldn't face in our relationship, and no challenge we couldn't solve if the trust was there. But the minute the trust is gone, it's all over. We become enemies, implicitly or explicitly. But trust is a difficult thing. You know, the ego doesn't like to trust anybody. And we often only like to trust people when we're going to get something back from it. The ego wants a big return, you know, whether it's, you know, narcissistic adulation or sex or whatever it is. But I'm talking about something that's much deeper. So trust is the key, and trust is what makes it all work. But trust is very difficult to come by, deep trust. So I feel that a lot of human relationships are very superficial. They're not ultimately that demanding. But because trust with this deep trust comes an obligation, and the ego doesn't like obligations. But if with that trust comes an obligation to be true. In my relationship with you and your relationship with me, there was an obligation to be true and to be authentic and honest. And yeah. So, in relationship to the forgiveness question, my sense of myself in this area, which is still a work in progress, is that I find almost universally that if the relationship has been problematic, and if feelings have been hurt, for whatever reason. I'm aware in my, I always, if someone is willing to meet me halfway from a place of openness and a willingness to trust, I'm willing to forgive whatever it was. I'm ready to meet in the heart, even if I haven't felt like it up till that moment. but if I get the sense that there's someone, they really mean it, that they want to bridge the gap, and that we're both willing to take responsibility for our part in the betrayal, whatever's happened, I feel in myself is a willingness to respond in the moment, because I feel the possibility of the return to trust is infinitely more valuable and more important and more, you know, much has much greater value than the resentment on both sides, and needing to kind of, you know, hack away at each other for whatever reason to be right and righteous and heard. Because once the relationship is rekindled, once the trust is rekindled, it's spiritually it's a huge relief, it's a metaphysical relief. That's why we save love in that sense, because so much love is destroyed because people have betrayed each other and are not willing to pay the price of healing. Now, in terms of forgiving people, forgiveness, the hook, line, and sinker, simply within one's own heart, that kind of thing is not that clear to me. I work on that, but I can't say I really trust it in myself. What I do trust is my willingness to kind of put down my weapons. If I feel the potential that we're really going to be able to trust each other again, then I don't care what happened. I'm willing to start with forgiveness and put it right on the table. But in terms of working it all out on my meditation cushion and having it all taken care of, that's not something I'm not so sure I need to be.
And those are big questions and difficult to answer. And I like your answers.
Thank you.
Now, specifically, there's forgiveness, there's reconciliation, which are two different things, perhaps, probably. And then, people willing to see their part in it, almost like a repentance.
Sure, absolutely.
The Greek word is metanoia, I believe.
Yes.
Of a change of mind and a change of heart, even.
Yes, absolutely.
It's hard to forgive when there's no repentance.
Probably pretty almost impossible, sure.
Well, I'm glad to hear that this is a work in progress for you too. I find it extremely hard.
Gil, listen, I'm an evolutionary. That's my metaphysical, philosophical, existential position in relationship to the totality of realities. I'm an evolutionary. So, and being an evolutionary means I'm a work in progress. And as long as I'm a work in progress, then I can't claim to be perfect. And I've never met anybody that's perfect, and I don't think anybody has ever existed that's perfect. There have been some extraordinary human beings that had profound levels of spiritual realization and attainment, but that doesn't mean that they're perfect at the level of being human. Mm. It's not the same thing.
They're still fallible.
Yeah, everybody's fallible. My guru once said to a very close friend of mine when they were alone in the room, he said to my friend, he said, always remember to make a distinction between the man and the master.
What is that distinction?
It's just what we're talking about. It means that the master has access to enlightened awareness and has a profound attainment and stabilized in that attainment and in that context can reveal the ultimate mystery that lays beyond life and death. That doesn't make them a perfect human being.
You mean the man the mass to the same person, the master and the man in one, you mean?
Exactly. So the master is not a perfect man.
Look, I have another question.
Okay, one more, then we'll keep going.
This is about, is it off topic, but this is about evil, the whole subject of evil in the world or in people.
Yeah, I think that'll take us all into different territory. And I think it's a good question, but I would prefer if we could stay on topic since I spent about an hour trying to lay it out. But I'd be happy to try and answer that question in a different context.
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you, Gil.
Thanks, Andrew.
Sure.
There's a terrific line from a movie which says, the best trick the devil ever pulled was convincing the world he didn't exist. Now, in our sort of very modern secular world, you know, everything is relative, the idea that there is no good and bad, it's just thinking that makes it so, it's all relative, there's no such thing as evil, it's all neutral perhaps. Now, I'm not sure if I agree with that.
Me neither.
And I'm wondering, what is the nature of evil? And what's the definition of evil, and then what's the nature of it?
This is a very complex question. We don't have time to go into it all now. Also, I'm not an expert on this subject, but I'll tell you one thing. I know that there are forces. If there are forces of light, spirit means spiritual light, which means consciousness. If that is a force that exists in the universe, and it sure is, because I've experienced a lot of it, I continue to do so. There's also the existence of the opposite of that light, which is darkness, what you call bad motives and bad intention, and just as forces that seem to overwhelm people and consume people. And I've seen these forces sometimes overtake people, and seen people change, their character change almost in a few seconds. They seem to become possessed by some dark force. This wasn't just the expression of kind of a schizophrenic personality, but there seemed to be something other at work that definitely was not positive, wholesome, good, or true, or beautiful. And I've seen this too often to be able to just say evil doesn't exist. Of course, we know a lot of what leads to evil behavior comes from non-integrated trauma, and people who have been treated very badly tend to treat other people very badly. But I'm speaking about something that includes that, but that transcends it also. Mm-hmm. But one definition of evil that I came up with a long time ago is this: I don't care. Mm-hmm. And even worse than I don't care is I don't care that I don't care.
Mm.
So not caring, and not caring about the fact that you don't care, creates a rather soulless, depraved, potentially very dark situation in the self. So one definition of evil that I came up with a long time ago is I don't care, and I don't care that I don't care. And to me, that's a very, very dangerous place for the...
I agree. I think that's great.
So to be, yeah.
I think that's...
Sorry to interrupt you. So therefore, the opposite of not caring is caring. So the more we care about these metaphysical, ethical, and philosophical truths, these existential truths, the more we care about them, the more vulnerable we have to be. The more somebody cares, the more they begin to stand out. They can be seen. This makes us feel very vulnerable and potentially very threatened. So it takes a lot of courage to care deeply about these things.
Yeah.
You become much more vulnerable and much more vulnerable. But if you don't care and you don't care that you don't care, then you don't have to give a damn. So may we all do all the spiritual work we need to do to care absolutely. Okay, very good. Thank you, Gil. Thank you, everybody. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you, Andrew. Thanks.
Thank you.